That is beautiful.
Well, we even got the wire in there.
You guys do have the wire in there, don't you?
Yeah, it works. The hole's drilled, everything.
Neat. Yeah, how are we going to do that?
I don't know.
We were like, oh,
we
how,
did
do,
it.
How do we come up with 25, 50 of those? Just do a hardware search and find something.
Yeah. Right, try and really find this on eBay. Right.
And those are the those are the finished patterns, if I remember correctly.
This stuff fascinates me, too.
That is gorgeous.
So Graham machined these, if I remember.
Me and Steve did.
Yeah. So they were drawn, and Graham was in my drafting class.
So what am
class.
I seeing here? Yep. I don't understand what I'm seeing.
Yeah.
These are machined?
Yeah, these patterns are machined. What this is the whole pattern itself with the gating runner. These here would be the gates where the metal flows through, and then this is the runner. Now, it's hard to visualize. You'll get a lot better visualization once you look at the sand mold itself, and you can kind of compare apples to apples. But
so the material is gonna technically would go down this.
This is the sprue, so that's where the metal goes down to begin with.
And then that actually comes in here, am I correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That is
correct. It flows through, and then as it flows through, it'll go through these gates into these parts. But you're looking at a bottom and a top. You're looking at the
right,
bottom,
right. So it's hard for me to put it all together, but I can kind of get it. Wow.
What's critical is that we were able to get all the draft. You know, appropriate so that way the molds would pull apart. This one, I think, was one of the ones that was the most challenging just because we wanted to make it 90 degrees. That way when it's, you know, was on the windowsill itself, it wasn't at an angle.
Right.
So what you had to do was prop it up 2 degrees. So you'll see this in here, how it's a little higher.
Right.
Then this is recessed here. That's because it's set in at 2 degrees. That way it has the draft necessary.
Otherwise you wouldn't be able to pull it out of the sand and bust the sand out.
Now the inside has draft, but that's not as critical as the 90 degrees this way.
So when the molds get made in the cope and drag, this gets actually, that's what this core print is for.
Right.
It references that thread perfectly.
Based
vertical.
On these tapers in here.
It was.
So this was a little tricky, just because you had to use really small, you know, ball end mill as you got down to the edges here. And be able to surface
all
that.
So this is all CNC.
Yeah, correct. That was all done in these machines behind us here.
So something that always comes to my mind is I know this is kind of like challenging to kind of recreate. So do you think the original hardware went through the same process, or did they have an entire different manufacturing scenario?
They still used sand.
They still used sand.
It was probably green sand, I would assume. We don't really know. I mean,
but I mean, were these things hand carved out of, like, you know?
Yeah.
You know,
traditionally molds were, even the main patterns were hand carved, hand machined. I mean, they had machining technology 100 years ago, but it's not, you know, the nice fancy piece of equipment you see here. It's going to be the you know, someone sat there with a chisel and a hammer and kind of cut it out, or a little more manual method, especially when you start looking at these threads. So, not an easy sample.
It's all beautiful. I mean, if we can get 50 more, especially, because we had someone make this for us, and they just sent us some bolts that they had welded to, you know, they did everything this did, except they had to turn it, like, you know, 13 times to get it, you know.
Well, that was another one of the challenging things, is we essentially had to come up with our own thread. And, you know, this isn't something you can go look at a chart, oh, it's this many, you know, revolutions per inch or whatever. And
creating a thread that can be cast, that was the other thing, is we could come up with any kind of thread pitch we wanted, but it has to be able to pull.
Unbelievable.
You made every kid draw, a screw in the plate?
Yeah, drew all those parts, whether they wanted to or not. Even though I think we used yours in the end. I had to pick a student. I mean, I couldn't take this part from one student and that part from and know that they would fit perfect. So I had to pick one student, and half it was Graham, because he was also in CNC.
Way to go, Graham. So yeah. You were involved in it. You just cast it because you had did the drawing, right?
Yeah. Yeah. That was. I just kind of, I guess, followed the drawing through.
So you were drawing all the way.
Babied the part through the processes.
He won't admit it, but he's one of our stars over here on the CNC. He's had more time on these machines than I've had because he's.
Casting on this is like really rustic.
Yeah, but that might have survived the fire or two.
It's conceivable. You can kind of see the file marks. It's neat.
Well,
it's really interesting. Is this is the
class,
the third attempt at reproducing it? The first two failed miserably, so it's a success story on that count.
Okay, go ahead. Are you going to put a disc on top of them?
This is a shop blaster. It's got a wheel that accelerates little metal beads into the material that we're trying to clean up to blast off any sand particles, any debris, and it does this as it tumbles around in a big mill. And eventually it'll come out as a really clean surface. You'll see in a second.
And that's the part we just cast.
That's the part we just cast, yep. About 30 seconds.
I don't know what we do without this machine. This does a really good job at getting all the sand off.
Yep. Yeah, it's good.